this ain't going to happen anyway. Amen. Because God's grace, you know, the Bible says that the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared unto what? All men. Teaching us that we are to deny what? Ungodliness, worldly lust, that we should live righteously, soberly, godly right here in this present world. Because we are looking for that blessed hope, hallelujah, and the glorious appearing of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Who gave himself us for us so that he might what? Purify us from all iniquity. And to what? Amen. And to present to himself and to form a people that will be what? Zealous of what? Good works. All right. Now, a person that backslide, a person that gets slothful, that gets in their sin, complacent, slow, won't pray, won't have come to church, won't read the Bible, these people are backslidden. They are seriously backslidden. They're not motivated. They're not on fire. They never even speak to their own relatives, their own people that they live in the house with, because they don't have the motivation. They don't have the zeal in them. They don't have enough fire in them even to reach their own family. If they came out, amen, praise God, and praise God, I believe that God could turn some things around. Amen. All right. Look here. When a righteous man doth turn from his righteousness and commit iniquity, and I lay a stumbling block before him, he shall die. Because thou hast not given him warning, he shall die in his sin. And his righteousness, watch that, and his righteousness which he hath done shall not be remembered. But his blood will I require at thine hand. Nevertheless, if thou warn the righteous man that the righteous sin not, and he doth not sin, he shall surely live, because he is warned. Also thou hast delivered thy soul. So your ministry, you might want to take note of this, your ministry or to warn those that's outside of the what? The body of Christ. These are sinners. Because if you don't warn them, now, that doesn't mean you go down to every house in this neighborhood, go all over Tulsa, you say, well, I just feel that I haven't done God's will unless I just reach every house, amen, all 50,000 houses. No, you only deal with people that God, what, connects you with, that cross your path, amen, that you have the opportunity. I think that God might hold some of us responsible for our neighborhood. Amen. Just a block of, around, you know, a few blocks. Amen. We could, amen, get out and meet people. Some of us don't even know our neighbors. All right. All right. So some people say, well, my call is to go to Africa. And you scared to even knock on the door of your neighbor, next door neighbor. You're scared. Amen. See, the Holy Ghost is designed to what? Get you out of fear. Put some boldness and put some what? Boldness in your what? Bones. Hallelujah. That's what we... Okay. Nevertheless, if thou warn the righteous man that the righteous sin not, and he does not sin, he shall surely die, because he is warned. Also, thou hast delivered thy soul. Okay? Sinners, our prime target should be sinners. Number two. One. Number two, it should be what? Our saints are people that have known the Lord that's drifting away. We are calling these people backsliders. Amen. Getting on the phone and dealing with what? People that don't show up for church. People that have lost their first love. People that are neither cold nor hot. People that have lost their zeal and fervor. Amen. Praise God. That is the second area that we should be concerned. Now, God will hold us accountable for that. People within the church that we can read, you know, everybody, you know, none of us are that crazy. We don't know who ain't here tonight. Amen. We know, amen. And I think it would be good to what, exhort believers. Amen. That's just what the scripture says, that we are to what, exhort one another as we see the day of the Lord what, approaching. We are to exhort one another to be what, faithful, to be committed. Jesus is coming soon. His coming is imminent. All right. All right. So have I convinced you that you can lose your reward after You can build your spiritual porch up to the ceiling and turn around and get in the flesh. Is that right? And you can what? You can lose those rewards that you have reward, that you have wrought. You can lose. All right, now, and that's what the church at Philadelphia, which was the good church, and this church produced more fruits than any church in the history of the Christian faith. Amen. That was the church full of good works. Full of good works. Amen. The church before that was the Sardis church, and they were the church, the dead church. The dead church. They were the church that just had forms and customs and ecclesiastical styles and the liturgical things. That was that church. But this church in Philadelphia was the church which he says that him that overcometh, he will not. Well, let me do verse 11. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Amen. So that means that your crown, those points that you have accumulated, amen, when you were really on fire for God, those points can be what? Diminished. And somebody else can what? Step up and what? Get the credit, amen, that you deserve. So that's Revelation 3. So I gave you three or four scriptures. Now one more scripture I want to give you about the Apostle Paul, 1 Corinthians 9. I do this over and over because I feel that sometimes we have to learn by repetition. This is 1 Corinthians 9. It says that, know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize. So run that ye may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. I therefore so run, not as uncertainly. So fight I, not as one that beateth the air, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a cast away. Amen. Now, I don't see how Paul could ever think that he could ever become a castaway, performing all of those works that he did and going through all of the things that he went through. Turn to 2 Corinthians 11:24. These are some of the things that Paul went through, yet he was concerned about not, amen, getting the full measure of those rewards that he was striving to receive. All right, he says that, let's do verse 23. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more. In labors more abundant. I mean, in other words, his efforts superseded all of those other apostles and ministers. In stripes above measure, in prison more frequent, in death of the Jews 5 times receive I 40 stripes save one. Thrice was I beaten with rods, once was I stoned, thrice I suffered shipwreck, and a night and a day I have been in the deep, in journeys often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils by my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils of the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils of the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. Beside those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. All right, so Paul went through a whole lot, but he was concerned that he would not, if he didn't keep his body under subjection, that he would be deprived of having the full rewards that he was striving for. Amen. He said, I would be a castaway. So, you know, you can make it to heaven by the skin of your teeth. Y'all know that, right? And have no reward? How many know that already? But how many want to have an abundant interest into the kingdom of the Lord? How many want to get in with flying colors? All right, so we want to emulate the Apostle Paul. Is that right? Okay, now, basically, all of these letters were showing the believer that you're just not going to walk in heaven without what? Paying the price. You got to become an overcomer, right? Whatever were pointed out, whatever scriptures that we've been sharing regarding the state. See, God is coming back for a chaste bride. Y'all believe that? Amen. He wants you to be in excellent shape. How many remember when you were engaged to your spouse? Did you want him to be chaste or she to be, her to be chaste? Amen. Did you want him hanging around with old Tom? Hanging out at the club, drinking, listening to all kind of old garbage. Is that right? Going to the casinos, to the club. How many wanted your spouse? Amen. If you saw any kind of imperfection, any little thing of concern, anything that you thought that might what not be quite right, you would easy quickly to what point it out. You were watching every little thing. I mean, you were watching them. I mean, you were watching every move because you wanted a what? A chaste bride. You wanted somebody that would be what? Would be what? Trustworthy. Somebody that would be faithful and true and pure. Hallelujah. So that's what Christ is looking for. Amen. So I'm going to show you James. If I could point out the virtue that perhaps would be the most important virtue of all virtues that we need to develop to be pleasing to God, I would choose the virtue of wisdom, because to me, wisdom is the result of walking in love over a period of time. It's love in its perfect state. It's love refined. Amen. Once you develop wisdom, you have what? You've gone through some stuff. Amen. Is that right? You put up with a whole lot of stuff because what? Love, amen, our strength is made perfect in what? Weaknesses. We got to suffer some things and go through some things and take some things, right? And you got to what? Maintain the right attitude. You got to be, amen, if you ain't kind when you're going through what? Hardships, you're the wrong kind. Read 1 Corinthians 13. Love is what? Is kind. Love does not what? Act unseemly. Just read about all of the attributes of love. Now, if you could walk down and go through all of the things that love will, even how love responds, over a period of time, you will arrive at a place where you can actually make what? Good choices and good decisions and sound judgment. That's what I call wisdom. Amen. Now, of all of the things that the Bible speaks about that will give us grace, I believe that God has many avenues in which we can get the grace that we need in order to be an overcomer. Amen. You know, faith, faith is a way that we can what? Amen. We can get grace added to us. The Bible says through faith, grace and peace be multiplied through what? The knowledge. Amen. And our sister Hill mentioned last week that we got to add to our faith what? Virtue. Amen. That's what we read in 2 Peter. We got to add stuff because the more of these things you tap into and develop in your life, the more grace you're going to have, amen, to live an overcoming life. How many know God's grace is sufficient? Amen. Our problem is that what? We need to tap into grace. Amen. We need more grace. God is able to give us all the grace that we need in order to live a life that will be acceptable to Him. But it's going to what? It's going to be incumbent upon you to pay a price. You got to place yourself in a position where the grace of God can what? Can come in your what? In your life. You can't place yourself out of a range where God's grace, amen. If you're not in faith, God's grace is not going to what? Help you. Amen. The Bible says God resists the proud, but He gives grace to the what? Humble.
You got to be humble. You got to what? Submit to God. Amen. Submit to God means what? Submit to the Word. Submit to what? Amen. Submitting to the Holy Spirit. Submitting to your pastor. Submitting to, amen, everything that God told us to submit to. That's what it means. Because if you don't submit to God, you're not going to have power over the devil.
Amen.
Is that right? You got to know what? Submit to God first, and then resist the devil, and the devil will what? Flee from you. How many believe that? The devil will flee, but you got to what? Submit to God first. You know, when we were going to Rhema, and one of the teachers said, y'all got it all wrong. Y'all think you're not going to just kick the devil. Amen. Bam! And that's all we have to do. Can live any kind of life. Amen. Not living a nigga with a dog meat, but you got what? You can kick the devil out of the door. Open your door, back your front door, and what? Get out of here, Satan. Bam! And he told us, he said that it's not what you say, it's more in what you live than what you say. He said the whole thing is about 75 or 80% obedience. If you ain't living a nickel with a dog meat, amen, the devil ain't going to what? He ain't going to what? Submit to you. Amen. Most of the dominion that we're going to operate in, the power and authority that we're going to be able to exert as believers, primarily is what? Walking in obedience. If you're not walking in obedience, you're not going to even have confidence. Amen. This is a confidence that we have in Him. We can ask anything according to His what? Will. He heareth us. And if we know that He heareth us, then we know that we have a petition of the things that we desire of Him. But the Bible says He only hears us when we what? Keep His commandments and do those things that are what? Pleasing in His sight. Hallelujah. Oh, I feel like dancing tonight. Amen. So that's enough of that. Amen. Praise God. But that wisdom thing is the ultimate state of obedience. Is when you get to the point where you become a doer of the word. How many want to be a doer of the word? Amen. It doesn't matter how much you say, I'm saved, I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. You can buck like a billy goat. You can shake like jello. Buck like a billy goat. Amen. And you can say, I don't care how much you speak in tongues. See the bow tie fly. Amen. But if you're not walking in obedience, amen. If you're not a doer, how many can say a doer? You got to be a doer of the work. Everybody just, I got to become a doer. Amen. We kind of getting back. You know, we got to get back where we can be effective, more effective. And I believe it starts with consecration, fast, and self-denial. Getting back into the Word. Amen. Admonishing people. Amen. You can get on fire just calling people and sharing and what? Ministering to people.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. I see on the phone all the time. That right, Sister Eva? I stay on the phone. I just don't stay on the phone. Amen. But I go further than the phone. All right, but this scripture really blesses me. James 3, it says, but the wisdom that is from above is first pure. Everybody said pure. You got to be holy. And then it's just consistent with the scripture in 2 Peter 1:5. Sister Hill mentioned that a few Sundays ago. You got to add to your faith virtue, temperance, patience, knowledge, and all of that. But just look at that. The wisdom that is from above is first pure, then what? Peaceable, and gentle, and easy to be what? Entreated. Now this is a real spiritual refinement. This is the results of walking in love. Amen. Abounding in love. And when you abound in love, then your judgment, you're going to abound in knowledge. Make sound judgments, sound decisions. You're going to be easy to be what? To deal with. Easy to be entreated. Peaceable. Easy to be entreated. Full of what? Mercy. Everybody just said full of mercy.
Full of mercy.
And good fruits. Without partiality. And without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that what make peace. Okay, let me give you another passage that will illuminate that even further. Now, all of these scriptures are scriptures that are stressing the importance of us being a chaste virgin, a chaste bride. Christ is coming back for a church that have been what? Washed and purged from all of their iniquity. All of their iniquity. We got to get rid of all the tricks, all the hidden agendas, all the secret things, all of the things that's displeasing God. We got to what? Get rid of all of that so that we can become what? Pure and without fault. Amen. God wants the blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. That's the first scripture, one of the first ones I ever remember. All right, so that scripture in Philippians 1, I said 3, Philippians 1, verse 9, it says this, and this I pray, Paul was praying, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment, that ye may approve things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ. See, Christ is coming back for a church that's without offense. Without offense. That's sincere and without offense. Till the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness. Fruits of righteousness are things like helping people, blessing people, ministering to them, sharing, opening up the word. Amen. Praying with them. These are fruits of righteousness. And he tells us to be filled with the fruits of righteousness. Amen. So we can find a few numbers. In fact, I stayed up several hours yesterday. I said, I'm going to get every number of every person that we've made contact with recently. And we have these on the list. We have about 100 names, and with the phone numbers and addresses and all of that on a list. And but you don't have to really have a list. I think that you ought to be concerned enough to what? To meet people and then what? Even get their names on your own. How many can say amen to that?
Amen.
All right. So I'm just encouraging you tonight to be at your best, because Christ is coming for a chaste bride. Chaste bride. There's a scripture. Somebody help me find that. But he coming for a chaste bride. See, if you are with consider these scriptures and really try to get your life in line with the things that I'm sharing. What happens is that as you become more and more submitted to God, what happens is that the greater the anointing will begin to be released into your life. You'll want to pray. You'll want to see God. You'll delight in sharing, reaching out, and praying for people. Okay, this is 2 Corinthians 11. It says, verse 1, 2 Corinthians, would to God ye could bear with me a little in my folly, and indeed bear with me. For I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. Amen. I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin. Amen. So Christ is coming back for a chaste bride. And the scripture that we always use in Ephesians is that therefore as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives. This is Ephesians 5, 25. Husbands, love your wives even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. And the last scripture in Revelation, I believe it's Revelation 16. Revelation 14. I'm going to read Revelation 14. It says this, and they sung as it were, this is 144,000, and they sung as it were a new song before the throne and before the four beasts and the elders, and no man could learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. These are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. And in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. Okay, they're without fault. So, looking at all of those overcoming statements or admonition that Christ made to the seven churches, you can definitely see that Christ is coming for what? An overcomer. Yes, and he's not going to come down to our standard. We're going to have to what? Go up to his. All right, now, what I have done for you, the next unit is talking about, we're on chapter 4. I didn't make every point in those first three chapters, but of course the lukewarm church, the Laodicean church, we talked about, we wore that out already, y'all heard that over and over. But we want to go to chapter 4 next week, and I gave you out a handout to show you. I want you to read that because there's a lot of controversy about when Jesus is going to come. Will it be before the tribulation period? Will it be at the midpoint of the tribulation? Would it be after the 7 years? And I have given you conclusive evidence that all of the early church fathers taught that it would be a pre-trib rapture, that Christ would come and snatch out the saints from it. Amen. He's coming down in the air. He's not coming to the earth to snatch us out, but we're going to be caught up to meet him in the air. And I've heard so many even anointed men of God say that the rapture teaching did not appear until in the 1800s, 1830. Charismatic, deranged woman had a vision of the rapture, and until that point, nobody had taught the rapture. Just a little deranged young lady had a vision of the rapture, and I believe that many of them said that John Darby, which was a kind of extremist with one of the fathers, he also promoted that particular doctrine of the rapture. But they said that that was the only known incident of anybody ever mentioning the rapture. But that's not true. And I showed you in this material that you can go back to the early fathers, father after father. All of these were renowned and recognized men in the church. And I have a lot of these people listed that they taught the rapture. Even the first one that we mentioned knew the 12 disciples of Jesus personally. And he knew that they personally told him that they believe in the rapture of the saints, and it would be before the tribulation period. So you got a lot of evidence there to refute any kind of misunderstanding that you might hear concerning the time of that great event that's supposed to take place. I want you to look over it because they kind of go over all of the different aspects of the rapture. You can get a better understanding, a better feel of it. And I don't have all of the information there, but we've got a few more pages to add to that. But that's enough for you to start out with. And next week, we are going to talk about the rapture and break it down so you can understand it. And also, after the rapture and the church is removed, then we're going to show you the Antichrist ascends to power, peace taken from the earth, the famine, pestilence, the nuclear destruction, and the beast of the field will claim 1/4 of the world population. We talk about the fiery nuclear holocaust that will kill 1/3 of the world's population. The 144,000 Jewish evangelists, seal of God in their forehead. The demonic creatures released out of the bottomless pit to torment men for 5 months. We'll talk about all of these 3 major earthquakes that will take place that will cause the nations of the earth to fall. And we're going to talk about, you know, all of these things that were included in the 7 seals, the 7 trumpets, and the 7 bowls. And we're going to talk about the man of sin. And it's going to be very, very enlightening. All right, how many were promising that you will read this before we get back? All right, and read, make sure you're up to chapter 6. Make sure you are up to chapter 6. I can give you a lot of, right, in that particular paper, you will see all of the different reasons why the scripture definitely teaches that the rapture will take place before the man of sin is revealed, before the 7 mystery years. So all of that information is in there. Just about every point that you need to consider. All right, so it's up to you if you're going to read it. We're so happy tonight for all of you. Amen. So I'm up to chapter 4, and where the door is open and the saints are released, and the voice from heaven says, "Come up hither." Amen. After chapters 4 and 5, you don't see the church found in the book of Revelation anymore until they are coming back with Christ in chapter 19. Amen. To rule and to reign with Christ. Amen. During the millennium reign. Amen. Praise God. All right.